We have the normal force and the shear force, and together they form the force K2. Between N1 and S1, we had the internal friction angle, the phi, and between N2 and S2, we have the external friction angle, which we call delta. In both cases, if you take the tangent of the angle, you get the friction coefficient. So you have an internal friction coefficient and you have an external friction coefficient. The external friction coefficient can never be bigger than the internal friction coefficient, and the same applies for the relation between cohesion and adhesion. Adhesion can never be bigger than cohesion. In fact, theoretically, it could. So suppose the delta, the external friction, is bigger than the internal friction. What would happen if you have a cutting process? Well, it means a layer of particles will stick to the blade, and the material will fail one or two diameters, particle diameters, from the blade, because the internal friction in that case would be smaller than the external friction, so it will start failing internally. And with adhesion and cohesion, you will have the same effect. If theoretically the adhesion would be bigger than the cohesion, what would happen? A piece of clay, a small layer of clay, would stick to the blade, and at maybe 1 millimeter from the blade, the clay would start failing internally, and what you would measure on the blade is the cohesive force, the cohesion, and not the adhesion. So in all the cutting tests people did in the past, they always assumed the maximum external friction is the internal friction, and the maximum adhesive strength is the cohesive strength. So those were the forces on the layer cut. On the blade, we had the same forces, but in opposite direction. Action is reaction. Yeah, so you always have to keep in mind, are you looking at the layer cut or are you looking at the blade? Yeah, the difference is a minus sign, but that's it. Then we had the moments. And we don't really need the equilibrium of moments for normal cutting, like a blade cutting a layer of soil, because we already have enough equations. So normally we are not using it, but I will show you when we need the equilibrium of moments. You see that you have the normal force and the water pore pressure force here, and also on the blade with a certain acting point. Those acting points, yeah, they are difficult to determine. You can only determine the acting points, so where exactly is the force acting? You can determine that if you have, for example, finite element calculations and you know exactly the stress distribution on a blade. In such a case, you can determine where is the average, and that way you find those acting points. In a number of cases, we will need them, and I will show you how to deal with that. Well, we had resulting equations containing all the possible forces that you have. So we had the pore pressure force on the blade, pore pressure force on the shear plane, the gravity force, the inertial force, the cohesive force, and the adhesive force. What you can see in this equation is that I use capital letters for forces, and if we talk about stresses, like the cohesive strength and the adhesive strength, I will use the small letters. If you know this K2, the K2 is a force which is not horizontal, not vertical, it's under a certain angle depending on the external friction angle, but once you know this force, you know all the forces on the blade, and you can determine the horizontal and the vertical force, and here you see the equations. And what you see in those two equations is that you still have a pore pressure force in the final equations, and you also still have an adhesive force on the blade. So you have three terms actually on the blade. Those equations were generic equations, so they apply to all types of soil, and in fact you could also use those equations if you are cutting metal or other materials. Yeah, the equations are generic. One thing I should mention, to derive those equations we assume the shear plane is a straight line. Yeah, well, that was one of the assumptions. In reality, the shear plane does not always have to be a straight line. It could be a curved line, it could be a segment of a circle. Some researchers use what we call logarithmic spirals for shear planes, so they could have a shape which is not actually a straight line. The advantage of using the straight line approach is that all the equations can be derived, that the equations are more simple, so it gives you more insight in what is actually going on. You can see exactly which terms are in the equation, etc., etc. This gives you a picture where I put some of the forces. In fact, I neglected the gravity force and the inertial force, but the other forces are still there. So you can see you have an N1, then an S1, a C, and a W1, and here you can see how those forces can be combined in a factorial way, and then the resulting force should be equal to the factorial sum of horizontal and vertical force. So here you see the horizontal and the vertical force, and you can see how it what it looks like. You can also see in this picture that the W1 here, so that's the pore pressure force, is much smaller than the normal force. There is a reason for that. In fact, if you wouldn't have pore pressure forces, you would still have a normal force. But if you have pore pressures, you have to add up the pore pressure force to the normal force. So the normal force is always bigger. Yeah? The pore pressure I will explain in much greater detail later, but it's because you, if you have saturated material, so the water is everywhere, and you are deforming the material, the water pressure, which we call the pore pressures, will not be hydrostatic anymore. Yeah, it can change, but I explain today how that works. Well, on the blade you can make a same factorial sum of all the forces, and then you also get a feeling which force is big, which force is small, etc. Now, in the final equations, there is something you will not notice if you are not familiar with those type of processes, but you can see that we divide by the sign of the sum of all the angles that are involved. So we have the alpha, which is the blade angle, the beta was the angle of the shear plane, the delta, the external friction angle, and the phi, the internal friction angle. Well, if you divide by such a sign, everybody knows that if the sum of those angles gets close to 180 degrees, you have a problem, because the sign will be zero, and that would mean the force would become infinite. Yeah? So that's impossible. Well, when does that happen? If we already look at those angles, let's say the phi for hard sand, and in general in dredging, we are interested in predicting the worst case, so we are not going to look directly at the softest, loosest sand, because it will never be a problem to dig it. We will try to look at the worst case, so we will consider a very hard sand. In that case, the phi could be something like 45 degrees. The delta, the external friction angle, normally it's about two-thirds of the internal friction angle, so the delta would be 30 degrees. So together that's already 75 degrees. Then in sand, the beta could be around 25 degrees. So 75 plus 25 gives us 100 degrees. Yeah, so in such a sand, those three angles together will be about 100 degrees. We still miss the alpha. So what would be the alpha? Well, in dredging, normally we have an alpha around 55, 60 degrees. If you look at a cutter head, the angles are something like 55, 50, 55, 60 degrees. That means the total angle would be like 160 degrees. Well, the sine of 160 degrees is already relatively small. So if we divide by that, the force will be big. But in other applications, like with bulldozers, but also with tunnel boring machines, you can have blades with an angle of 90 degrees or even 120 degrees. Yeah, so if I would use a blade of 90 degrees, with those three angles being 100 degrees, it adds up to 190 degrees. And the sine of 190 degrees is negative. Yeah, if I would just apply this, a negative force means I have to pull back the blade because it wants to go by itself, because I have a negative force. Everybody understands that in reality that will never happen. So, what will nature do? Nature will find another mechanism for this cutting process, and we will look at what does that look like after this. First, here we had this picture, and I made a small table. And in this table you can see for each type of material, dry sand only has gravity and inertia. Saturated sand, so with saturated we mean water saturated sand. No air in between the particles, it's 100% water in the sand. So saturated sand has pore pressures, no gravity and inertia. In fact, it has gravity and inertia, but they are so small that we neglect them. You don't have cohesion and adhesion, but you have friction. And with friction, we mean both internal and external friction, and both types of friction. Clay has gravity and inertia, but they are so small, we can neglect them. Clay doesn't have pore pressures. In fact, there are pore pressures, but they are not relevant for the cutting process. Yeah, so we don't take them into account. Then clay does have cohesion and adhesion, but clay has no friction. And I will also get into detail into the friction issue. Rock cutting under atmospheric conditions, gravity and inertia can be neglected. Pore pressures can also be neglected. And why can we neglect the pore pressures? Because there could be pore pressures. Most types of rock have a certain porosity, so there could be water in the rock. But you always have to consider the relation between the strength of a material and the maximum under pressure that could occur in the material. So if I'm cutting rock, let's say at 10 meters water depth with a dredging tool like a cutter head, the under pressure that could occur in the pores of the rock has a maximum of 2 bar. Yeah, because you always have 1 bar atmospheric, and 10 meters water column is also equal to 1 bar, so in total you have 2 bar. So the maximum under pressure I could get is 2 bar, and 2 bar is 200 kPa. So that's the maxima I can get. If I compare this under pressure with the strength of rock, and in the case of rock we talk about compressive strength in general, well, the rocks that we cut in dredging can have a compressive strength up to 60 MPa, megapascal. Now, you can have weak rock, like 10 MPa, but 10 MPa is still 50 times as big as 200 kPa. So even if I have those underpressures in my rock, they are so small compared to the strength of the rock itself, it's not interesting. We can neglect them.
What is rock in soil mechanics? Is that little pieces of
dirt? No. Rock, if we consider rock, we consider a material which is not really homogeneous, but it looks homogeneous, like basalt. But if you have basalt, like the stuff we use for building dikes and so on, you shouldn't consider the separate blocks of basalt, but one huge mountain of basalt. And we actually cut that with cutter dredges.
I'm not that familiar in soils, but what is basalt? What is basalt?
Oh, you know that the black pieces of stone that we use in to cover dikes and to
yeah.
cover the other
waterways
and so on. Well, that kind of material we consider rock. Yeah, it's volcanic material, and they take out nice pieces to protect Holland, yeah, to protect dikes and so on. But in nature, you can imagine if you have a volcanic eruption, you have a lot of lava, and the lava solidifies, that could be basalt, you have a continuous mass of rock, of material. And if and this happened in Arabia, some sheikh has a nice palace, and he looks out the window and he says, that's where I want to have my port for my yacht. But when they look over there, they see it's rock. It's massive rock. Okay, so we have to remove it. Sometimes it would be cheaper to move the whole palace to a place where you have sand, but yeah, if they pay, they pay. And usually we are not allowed to use explosives, because sometimes we use dynamite to remove the rock. But if it's an environmental area or if it's close to an urban area, often you are not allowed to use explosives, so we have to dredge. Yeah, the price is higher, but if we have to, we have to, and as long as the customer pays, we will remove it.
And then you use a rock
cutter. Yeah, exactly. So, then we go to hyperbaric rock. Hyperbaric rock, in fact, the rock is the same. It's not a different type of rock, but we are cutting under hyperbaric conditions. What are hyperbaric conditions? Hyperbaric means that you have a very high hydrostatic pressure. And why do we look at that? Because the last couple of years, deep sea mining has become of interest. And in deep sea mining, I already told you, it could be 2-3 kilometers of water depth. Over there you find rare metals and so on and so on, but they are inside rocky material, stone, rock, whatever you want to call it, but it's not sand or clay. Okay, so we have to cut that material to get it to the surface and to get the copper, the gold, the silver and other materials out of it. It's like ore. But if you work at 3 kilometers water depth, you can calculate that you have 300 bars of hydrostatic pressure. If you have 300 bars, 300 bars is 30 MPa, and we can forget the 1 bar atmospheric once we talk about 300 bars. You could theoretically get an underpressure in the pores of the material of 300 bar. Well, 300 bar is 30 MPa, and 30 MPa is comparable with the strength of the rock. Yeah, so if I have a rock, let's say, with a compressive strength between 10 and 60 MPa, then 30 MPa is somewhere in the middle, so I cannot neglect it anymore. That means if I'm cutting hyperbaric rock, I also have to take into account the pore pressures. I have to look at them. I still have the cohesion, because rock has shear strength. Yeah, in fact, I shouldn't call it cohesion, I should call it shear strength in this case, but it's a matter of terminology. Rock usually doesn't have adhesion, so if you have rock or stone and you touch it on the outside, your hand will not stick to that, so it doesn't have adhesion. But it has friction. Rock has internal friction. Usually the internal friction is smaller than with sand. From research, I found that often it's like 20 to 25 degrees, the internal friction angle, and the external friction angle is about 2/3 of the internal friction angle. So the friction of rock is about 50% of that of sand, and you can imagine the reason for that is that in sand you have rather large particles, usually a very angular, while in rock, the particles inside the rock are much smaller, smoother, so the friction is less. Okay, how to solve the problem of the sum of those angles? Well, if you cut dry sand with a blade of, in this case, I thought it was 120 degrees. So here you have the blade. I'm pushing against the soil. And what do we see? We see that there's a sort of a wedge, and a wedge, een wig in het Nederlands, a wedge is like a triangle. There's a sort of wedge occurring in front of the blade. And you get a cutting process here. With here the shear plane, it's hard to see, but we measured it, and the sand will move over the blade. But the wedge is almost static. It means once you start pushing, this wedge will stay in front of the blade, and it will not really have velocity, so it's quite static. I will show you some measurements next week where we actually measured this. And one of the ways of measuring whether this wedge is static is by having friction sensors in the blade. And if the friction is maximum, it means it's moving. If the friction is less than the maximum, it means it doesn't move. So you can actually measure whether it's moving or not. And in fact, we put a window in the blade of very hard glass to actually see if the sand was moving, but that's for next week. I see you already have the slideshow from Blackboard. Well, if we have a wedge, first we should define the parameters that are involved. So we have a blade, again we have a blade angle alpha. Here we define a wedge angle theta. So you have the point A, B, and C like we had before, and now here we have point D. In fact, what we are doing, we are acting as if the wedge is a blade. Yeah, so the wedge, in fact, is a new blade, but it's made of soil, sand or clay, depending on the material. So this wedge, we consider it static, and we get a new cutting process with the wedge as the blade. It appears from many measurements that the angle theta doesn't change much. It's not really dependent anymore on this blade angle. Usually it's about 60 degrees, 60, 65 degrees. Depends on the internal friction angle, but it's around 60 degrees. That means once the blade angle gets so high that we get a problem with the dividing by that sine of the four angles, once that occurs, we will always get a wedge in front of the blade with an almost constant wedge angle. And because that wedge angle is constant, the forces will also be almost constant. It's not precisely, but almost. Here we have the beta again, and the height, the thickness of the layer cut, so the rest of the picture is the same. I will quickly show you the forces involved, because you have to consider a number of things in order to be able to deal with this. Well, in the shear plane, we have exactly the same forces. Yeah, nothing has changed. So, it's the same. The gravity basically is also the same. If the shape of that layer would be the same, the weight of that layer is also the same. So that doesn't change. But here, in this area, something is changing. What is changing? The forces look the same, but you have to consider that now you have, if it would be sand, you have sand over sand and not sand over steel. So the friction angle that we have here, probably it's a bit smaller than the internal friction angle because the material is already deforming, and when it's deforming the porosity increases, and so probably the angle is a bit smaller than the original internal friction angle, but it's bigger than the external friction angle. So this lambda I put here would be somewhere in between the delta and the phi of the material, let's say at 50%, roughly. Also for the cohesive force here, because you have clay on clay, if the material would be clay, it's not the real cohesion anymore, because the material already failed, so you have two surfaces of clay sliding over each other. But it's also not the adhesion, because the adhesion would be clay with steel. And you can imagine, if you have clay with steel, you only have the adhesive effect on one side, on the clay side. But if you have clay, on both sides I have an adhesive effect. So the adhesion, or the cohesion on this plane, will be less than the shear strength of the clay, but it will probably be more than the adhesion with steel. And how much it is, you have to measure. Yeah, you can't just give an answer to that. But for example, if you would have very hard clay, very hard and dry clay, then probably hard clay almost has no adhesion. So if I have two blocks of that very hard clay sliding over each other, probably there's not much left of the shear strength between those two surfaces. So both in case of the lambda and in case of the C, the strength or the friction is less than the original material, probably a little bit more than with steel. Okay, so that's the forces on the layer cut. But you can use exactly the same equations that we used for the original model. Yeah, because for the rest the geometry is the same. The forces on the wedge, and you can see on each plane, on each surface, you have forces. So those forces are the same again as the forces on the layer cut, but at the bottom, yeah, we can also have under pressure cohesive force, but remember, at the bottom, since the wedge is an almost static triangle, at the bottom it's also sliding, there's already a shear plane. So it's not internal sliding anymore, it's clay over clay again. So also this C will be smaller than the original shear strength of the material. And we have a normal force and a shear force due to friction. Here I put the phi, but in fact it could be a bit smaller than the original phi, because the material is already deformed. And then on the blade, we have the normal force, shear force again, the adhesive force. But since the wedge is not moving, this adhesive force does not have to be mobilized completely. And I don't know if you know what that means, but for example, if I take this box, the box will have a friction coefficient with the table, right? If I start pushing, as long as the force I use to push is smaller than the maximum friction force, this will not move. But in fact, I could also push in the opposite direction, and as long as the force is smaller than the maximum friction force, it will not start moving. So for something which is not moving, the only thing I know is that the friction force is between minus the maximum and plus the maximum. But where exactly it is, I don't know. And this counts for the adhesive force and for the friction force. So I know there will be some friction, but it's not 100% mobilized because there's no velocity. And if there's no velocity, I can also not say friction is opposite to the direction of velocity because there is no velocity. Yeah, so I cannot say it's upwards or downwards. We need additional equations to solve that problem. And those are the forces on the blade. The previous one were the forces on the triangle, this is on the blade. And then you can take the whole triangle, just take any point on the triangle, and you can solve the equilibrium of moments. Well, what we normally do is take the edge of the blade as the point where we determine the equilibrium of moments. But here you can see all the forces that would result in a moment. So we also have to solve those moments. And in fact, in the case of a wedge, I'm actually using the moment equation to determine how much of the friction is mobilized. Yeah, so based on the moment equation, you can determine in sand how much of the friction is mobilized, and in clay how much of the adhesion is mobilized. It's a lot of equations. Okay, that was the wedge problem, and with each type of soil, because after this we will consider different types of soil, with each type of soil I will show you how to deal with the wedge theory if we need it. The snowplow effect. If you look at cutting tools, usually they are not perpendicular to the direction of the velocity. So what we considered until now, we have a blade, we look at it as two-dimensional, and we have a velocity perpendicular to the blade. But if you look at cutter heads, for example, cutter heads are 3D curved. That means that in general a segment of the blade will not be perpendicular to the absolute velocity. And that's also almost impossible, because when you look at the operation of a cutter head, the cutter head is rotating, so you have a rotating movement, but it's also moving in the what we call the swing direction. So you get a combination of a rotation and a swing speed. The axis of the cutter head is not necessarily exactly in the direction of the ship, because it could be that the axis of the cutter head has a small angle compared with the ladder direction and the length direction of the ship. That could happen. Well, all those things together take care that the absolute velocity on a piece of blade is not perpendicular to that piece of blade. So you get something like in this picture. We have a velocity in this direction, but the blade has some angle compared with that direction. I call it the snowplow effect, because everybody knows those trucks with a blade in front under an angle they push the snow away, and you can actually see, depending on that angle, that the snow goes to the side. So that means the snow encounters a force in that direction, otherwise it wouldn't move to that direction, but it also means that truck encounters the same force in the opposite direction. How does it work? Well, here you see an example of what it looks like. This is the blade with the layer cut, and here I remove the blade and the layer cut, and you can see what it looks like. Well, in the lecture notes you can find the whole theory. I will not explain all the equations here, because it's my philosophy that everybody can study equations. So what I'm telling is the story around the equations. If you look at a cutting process where the blade is under a certain angle, like this is the blade, this is the shear plane. You can see here blade and shear plane. And we know that the friction is always opposite to the velocity. So we have to determine velocities and components of velocities, which you can see here. You have the forward velocity, which is separated in components perpendicular and to the side. So you can determine all those components. But the friction force is always opposite to the direction of the absolute total force. You cannot first separate velocities and then determine forces with a friction coefficient without realizing that the total friction is always opposite to the velocity direction. Everybody of you knows, I think knows, ABS in cars. And why do we have ABS? Well, if you drive on a slippery road, maybe because of water, maybe because of snow or ice, but it means the friction of the road is much lower than normal. You can steer, because as long as you don't have slip, as long as the tires are not slipping, the velocity between the tire and the surface is in the direction of the direction of the wheel. That means if you start braking, the friction force is opposite of that velocity direction, so it's always in the direction of your wheel. So as long as you don't have slip, you can use the steering mechanism to control the car, to go to a direction. But as soon as the wheel starts slipping, so suppose the car is going forward and you start braking and the wheel starts slipping, you can turn the steer, but the absolute velocity of the wheel is still straight forward, because the wheels are slipping. That means also the friction between the wheel and the road is in that direction, whatever angle you have of your wheels. It doesn't matter anymore, because the friction is opposite to the velocity direction. So what does it mean? It means you cannot steer anymore. It's gone. So you cannot control your car anymore. Okay, what do they do about it? What is ABS? In fact, they found that the maximum friction force between the wheel and the road is not at 0% slip, but at 2-3% slip. So you can have a little bit slip, a little bit difference in velocity between the wheel and the road, to have maximum slip. Well, and for each type of tire, you can determine where you have the maximum friction. So what does ABS do? ABS measures the rotational speed of your wheels, and if the ABS determines that the velocity doesn't match the car velocity, so it means you have slip, if they determine you have slip, they will reduce the braking force. Yeah, so you can still press the brake, but if you have a car with ABS and you use it on snow, a road full of snow, you can feel many shocks on your foot because the ABS is constantly taking away the pressure on the brakes because they don't want slip. And as long as you don't have slip, you can still steer the car. Now, of course, this will not work if the road is so slippery, like with snow and ice, that there is no friction anymore. Because, so some people think, I have ABS, I'm safe. Well, you are not. If there is no friction, ABS cannot do anything for you. But, for example, if the road is just wet because of rain, and you come from the highway and you have to take a division, and you have to brake pretty hard when you leave the highway, okay, in such a case, ABS will work fine and the car will not start slipping, while without ABS, it probably could. A danger of this is that people with a fancy car with ABS, they are used to it that they can leave the highway at maximum speed and then press the brake full, and nothing will happen. Everything will go right. But if such a person would rent a car without ABS, and he will still have the same driving behavior, he could get into a slip because he's not used to it anymore. Those things actually happen. Okay, so here we had the velocities. Based on those velocities, you can also determine all the forces and the force components. The problem of this, and that's in the next equations, to determine the forces, you need the effective friction perpendicular to the blade, because we have a 2D theory. So this is that effective friction perpendicular to the blade. It depends on the original friction coefficient and is a function of a ratio between two velocities. But what is the case? Those velocities, in fact, are a function of the effective friction. So you get what we call an implicit equation, where the effective friction depends on the ratio of some of the velocities, but the ratio of the velocities depends on the friction. If you have such a case, and I just put the equations here for the internal friction, external, but also for cohesion and adhesion, for all the equations it's the same, it means you have to solve it iteratively. Yeah, you cannot solve it explicitly, so just solve on a piece of paper. You have to use a computer to solve this. But if you have the correct algorithm, and in the lecture notes I put some code of Visual Basic, and you can see how to solve this problem. By the way, I have been writing lecture notes, and I will put them with each week on Blackboard. The chapter of that week I will put on Blackboard, and at the end I will put the whole lecture note, so you have the whole story. But by putting it on Blackboard chapter by chapter, you can see exactly which chapter is for which week and matches the PowerPoint presentations. Yeah, but at the end I will put the whole lecture note. Right now I saw is 372 pages, but more than 50% is appendices, and you don't have to study that, but it's a lot of graphs and things because I just like to put everything together. Yeah, we will have a break of 15 minutes and then continue. Weir and 3D effects. In fact, what we did until now, we looked at a two-dimensional process, except for the snowplow effect, where you also have 3D forces. How to deal with wear, slijtage, and 3D effects, and what are they? Well, normally when you start, you have a sharp blade or pick point or whatever. But as soon as you start cutting, there will be wear, and it often means that the edge, the point of the blade, will be flattened. And when it's flattened, you get extra additional forces. Now, it appears it's very difficult to have a theory for what exactly is happening and determining those forces. So what we do, if we first look at the normal cutting process, you can say, I have a horizontal force, I have a vertical force, and that results in a force under a certain angle. If I have small blade angles, the vertical force will be downwards, so with small blade angles, 30 degrees, maybe even at 45 degrees, the soil will try to pull the blade more into the soil. But if I have large blade angles, like 60 degrees or higher, the soil wants to push the blade out. So in this case, this is like a 45 degree blade, so we still have a downwards total force. Now, what happens if we have wear? If we have wear, that means this is not a sharp edge anymore, but you have a wear flat, that means you get an upwards force under the blade. Well, if I have an upwards force, I can also say, okay, I used to have a total force under a certain angle, because I get an upwards force, the resulting force is rotated upwards, and maybe the total force also increases, so I can use a wear angle and I can use a factor to determine the cutting forces. And then if for different types of wear I know this angle and this factor, I can apply that in my cutting model. So that's wear. In fact, wear is very complicated. The dredging contractors still don't really know everything about it. But for example, right now we have a graduate. He is just starting his master thesis for Boscalis. And what they want him to do is make a cutter model, so not just one blade or pick point, a model for all the pick points on a cutter head, make a model that determines the forces, and once you know the forces, maybe you can also determine the wear, and if you know the wear, you can determine the effects of wear on the total forces on a cutter head. Because if you have wear, often you have to pull harder on your winch to make the whole dredge move. And there will be a point where the force that you have to use for pulling, for swinging, is so high, the winch is not strong enough anymore. And usually that's when they stop and they say, we have to take off the whole cutter head and fix it. Put new pick points on or new blades on. So that's wear. For 3D effects, what do I mean with 3D effects? Well, standard, you use a 2D blade, the velocity is perpendicular to the blade, and you determine the forces with your theory. But on the sides of the blade, you will get a 3D effect. So if the blade is wide enough, you can assume everything is 2D. But around the sides of the blade, you will always have 3D effects. It's not a nice 2D cutting process anymore, and that means the forces there will not be exactly according to the theory. What we did when we did research, and I will show you the pictures of that next week, we made a center blade with a certain width, put two side blades beside it, and measure the forces on the center blade to avoid those 3D effects. But we also measured the 3D effects on the side, because once you know what happens in the center blade and you compare it with the side blades, you can see the difference and you can see what the side effects are. In fact, for those side effects, we use the same system as for wear. You have the total force, you make it rotate over an angle, in this case it could be downwards. You put a factor on the force, so you have an angle for the side effects, you have a factor for the side effects, and that's how you determine those effects. We will move to the next presentation. First, we will look at dry sand. I already told you which parameters are important in dry sand. Well, dry sand, when you cut it according to the shear mechanism. So you get discrete shear planes, and the distance between two shear planes would be like 1 centimeter or 2 centimeters. So every time when the blade moves forward, you get a buildup of stresses. At a certain point, those stresses are so high that you exceed the shear strength of the material, the internal friction. A shear plane will shoot to the surface, and then the same happens again. The blade moves forward, and as soon as the stresses are high enough again, the next shear plane. So this is actually what it looks like. Which forces do we have in dry sand? So I will show you for each type of material which forces do you have and what are the final equations. In the case of sand, we have the normal force and the shear force. We have the inertial force, we have the weight, and here on the blade you also have a normal force and a shear force. So the pore pressure forces are gone, and also the adhesion and the cohesion has gone from the equations. This is all that's left. On the blade, we only have the normal force and the shear force, the friction force. That's it. And for the moments, if we would need it, we also only have the normal forces, because the shear forces are in the direction of the edge of the blade, so they do not result in a moment around the edge of the blade. Those are the resulting equations. So what I did is just take the equations for all types of soil, remove everything that is not of interest for dry sand, and what is left is the G term and the I term. And I think I already told you that the G term is always there. The I term only if you have high velocities. If you have low velocities like 1 meter per second, the I term doesn't really do anything, but at 10 meters per second it does. So basically this equation you can use for a bulldozer in dry sand or any other equipment. But these equations assume you do not have any water between the particles. Yeah, it's completely dry. Then we go to saturated sand, and saturated sand is a little bit more complicated. Same cutting process, the shear type. It may, if you look at the pictures I showed you yesterday, it may look a little bit different, but basically the process is almost the same. The difference that we will get is because in saturated sand you get underpressures in the pores, and those underpressures may keep the sand together much more. Yeah, with dry sand you don't have those pore pressures, so it's loose material. Underwater the underpressures keep the material together. Well, which forces do we have? The same as in dry sand, except we don't use the G and the I anymore. We have the normal force and the shear force on the shear plane, but now we also have the underpressures. And I will talk more about those underpressures later. On the blade, also normal force and shear force, friction force, and the underpressure force. If we go to the blade, you see the same forces in opposite direction. So also here the underpressure in the pores. And here you see the moments. So now we added those two underpressure forces because they play a role in the moments. The resulting equation Nee. Geen idee. Well, I will just keep on talking and the boxer started with the total equation, deleted everything that's not of interest, and this is what left. And you can see you have the two pore pressure forces, no G, no I, no cohesion, no adhesion, but you still have the two friction angles in the equation. Okay, what happens? If you are cutting sand underwater, and this is also valid for hyperbaric rock cutting, so for deep sea mining, what happens before you start cutting, the particles are close to each other, you have a dense sand, so the porosity, the pore space between the particles is small, could be 30%, 34%, depends on the type of sand. Now, just imagine you have two pieces of sandpaper, schuurpapier. You put them on top of each other, you press, and you try to make the top one move with respect to the bottom piece of sandpaper. At first, it doesn't want to move because all those particles stick in between each other and they take care that you can't really move it. So what to do? Well, if you lift the top paper just a little bit, so the particles, the sand particles, can move over the bottom part, it will start moving. That also happens if you try to shear sand internally. Because those you can see here that those, although those are spheres, they stick a little bit in between each other and they cannot move with respect to each other if they are not first increasing the space a little bit, if they move a little bit with respect to each other. So that's actually what happens. The particles have to move up a little bit in order to pass the underlying particles. That means after shearing it looks like this. You have more pore space, more porosity. But we are underwater. What does it mean if we are underwater? It means the extra pore space has to be filled with water. It cannot be filled with air because there is no air. It has to be filled with water. Well, water, and it all happens near the shear plane because that's where we are shearing. This effect we call dilatation. Dilatation is the increase of the porosity due to shear stresses. Yeah, it usually happens because of shear stresses. So I have an increased porosity near the shear plane. When will water flow there? Because water has to flow to that area. It has to come from somewhere. Well, when will water flow? It will flow if there is a pressure difference. It's the same as with air. You only have wind, Yeah, in the atmosphere, if there is a pressure difference between two areas, and then the air starts to flow, and that's what we call wind. So you need a pressure difference. But you can imagine if in the shear plane I have some, I need some water, that the pressure outside, so everywhere around it, will not change. So if I'm cutting at the seafloor, whether it's with a dredge or something else, a trencher, or the pressure in the water will not change. It will be hydrostatic. Yeah, so very close above the sand, I will still have hydrostatic pressure. That will not change. Okay, so if I need water in the shear plane, how can the water go there if the pressure in the shear plane is lower than the hydrostatic pressure, because water will only flow from high pressure to low pressure. So I need a pressure difference. So the only possibility for the water to flow to that area is if the pressure in the shear plane is lower than the hydrostatic pressure. So that's actually what will happen. We call it under pressure. And the under pressure is not only in the shear plane, the under pressure is in this whole sand area. I get a certain pressure distribution. And if I would integrate the under pressure over the shear plane, so if I know the under pressure everywhere in the shear plane and I integrate it, I would find this W2, the pore pressure force, the water under pressure force. So it's the result of the under pressure. And if I would know the under pressure over the whole blade and I integrate it, I would find my W2, which was the under pressure force on the blade. Yeah, so I do need those under pressures. Now, what is the effect of those under pressures? You can compare it when you go to the supermarket and you buy vacuum-packed coffee, the old-fashioned way, the rectangular brick. Yeah, you buy that, you can feel it's hard. You could even kill somebody with it if you want to, but I wouldn't advise. They will do DNA research and they will discover who you are. But anyway, so the coffee is very hard. Why is the coffee very hard? Because we have another thing in soil mechanics, and it's the rule of effective stresses. In soil mechanics, you have the total soil stress, you have the effective stress, which we also call the grain stress, and you have the pore pressure or the water pressure. Now, the total stress in a soil is always equal to the effective stress plus the pore pressure, always. So if I take a piece of soil and I would go to 1 meter deep into the soil and it's underwater, and I would measure the total stress, then that total stress is equal to the grain stresses plus the pore pressures. Okay, if that's true, everybody can understand that this total stress, the soil stress, does not change if I change something in the soil. The total stress is a constant. It's just the weight of the soil. So what does it mean if I get dilatation somewhere in the soil and I get much lower pore pressures? That can only occur if the grain stresses increase, because the sum of the two is a constant. And that's what happens with this coffee. The total stress in the coffee is a constant, but if I have a large under pressure in the pores, it means the grain stresses must increase because the sum of the two is a constant. Well, if the grain stresses increase, then the normal stress between particles is increasing, and that means if I have a friction angle, also the friction force is increasing, because the friction force is proportional to the normal stresses. Yeah, so that's the reason why vacuum-packed coffee feels very strong, very solid, it's because I have high grain stresses, particle stresses, and thus I have very high friction inside the coffee. But if I just punch a hole in the coffee, the under pressure goes away, it becomes normal atmospheric pressure. When the under pressure goes away, the normal stresses between the particles decrease to a normal level, and that also means the friction goes away, yeah, because friction goes with normal stresses. And suddenly it becomes very soft material. The same thing happens here, because I get those under pressures between the pores, my grain stresses increase, because the sum of the two is a constant. That means also my friction is increasing, because my friction depends on the normal stresses, and if my friction is increasing, then it becomes much more difficult to shear the sand, and that is actually what is happening in sand. So this effect we call dilatation, so it's the increase of the porosity as a result of shear stresses. Now, if you have this, you can say, okay, so I get some under pressure in the pores, how much would the forces increase? In fact, those under pressures in the pores, they can increase so much that they reach what we call the water vapor pressure. The water vapor pressure is the pressure at which water starts to boil, starts to cook, and this water vapor pressure depends on the temperature. Everybody knows that at 100 degrees centigrade the water vapor pressure is 1 bar, because that's when water starts to cook. But at 10 degrees centigrade, and usually we look at 10 degrees because when we are dredging the water, not at the surface but 10, 20 meters below the surface, we'll have a temperature of 10 degrees, maybe even less, 4 degrees. So you should look at low temperatures. Well, at 10 degrees, the water vapor pressure is 0.01 bar. That means I need an absolute pressure of 0.01 bar, 1/100th of a bar, to make water cook. In all our equations, we just neglect the 0.01 and we just act like it's zero, because it's just 1% of 1 bar. Well, the pressures in the sand can actually, in the pores of the sand, can actually become so low that they reach this 0.01 bar. What does it mean? It means the water starts cooking in the pores of the sand. We call it cavitation. You also have the same cavitation in the propulsion of ship. Ship's crews, they have cavitation, and in pumps, centrifugal pumps, you can also have cavitation at the entrance of a pump. And in those cases we don't really like it, because cavitation means water starts cooking, which means you get water vapor bubbles, you actually get bubbles. But if the pressure increases a little bit, they implode, those bubbles, and if this happens on the screw of a ship, those imploding bubbles are like an explosion, and they cause what we call cavities, small holes in the surface of the ship screw. Same can happen in a centrifugal pump. If you get cavitation at the entrance of the pump, yeah, the pump is meant to increase the pressure, so in the pump the pressure will increase, and that means all those water vapor bubbles will implode. You can actually hear it when it happens, it makes a lot of noise. It will damage the impeller of the pump, and yeah, you have to replace the impeller if it goes on for too long. And in fact, when this happens, the pump will not actually give a lot of pressure anymore, because the whole pump is full of water vapor bubbles. And centrifugal pumps are based on centrifugal force, which is the mass times revolution squared, times divided by the radius, or no, times the radius. But if the mass is zero because the whole pump is full of water vapor bubbles and not full of water, you don't have centrifugal force anymore, so you don't have pressure anymore. So the pressure completely collapses and the pump is damaged. So that's what happens with cavitation. In the case of a cutting process, you have the same cavitation, so in this area, but we don't really mind, because in this case it means the underpressure cannot increase anymore. You have a limit to your underpressure, which is absolute zero. That's the limit. If we look at the implication for forces, here I made a graph with the cutting velocity and here the horizontal force. What you can see at very low velocities, first the force, also the pressure, increases proportional to the velocity. So if I double my velocity, I double my underpressure, I double my force. That's what happens at low velocities. But at a certain point over here, I reach an underpressure which is 0.01 bar. I get cavitation, the pressure cannot increase anymore, and since force is pressure times cross-section, it also means my force will not increase anymore. So from there on, the force is a constant. It doesn't change anymore. And you can see that here I have water depth zero, so the force remains constant. But if I have 10 meters water depth, at 10 meters water depth, the maximum under pressure is not 1 bar, but 2 bar, because I have to add the 10 meters of water column, so I could get a double under pressure. That means the limit at 10 meters is 2 times the limit of 0 meters, and you can go on 20 meters, 30 meters. So the point where I get cavitation depends on the water depth and depends on the velocity. If I have more water depth, I need a higher velocity to get full cavitation. You can see that in this graph. Now, we would like to know what is exactly going on in the sand, and this is a picture I once made to determine how to put this in finite element programs. Because you cannot really solve the problem of those underpressures analytically. You need some finite element program and determine what is going on there. But for a finite element program, you need what we call boundary conditions. You have boundaries, and at each boundary you have to tell exactly what is going on there. Can the water still flow through a boundary, or is the boundary impermeable? Well, if you look at the blade here, the blade is impermeable. On an impermeable wall, you can say that the dp, dn, n is the normal on that surface, dp, dn is zero. If there would be a dp, dn, it means there's a velocity. Well, since water cannot flow through the blade, we don't have velocity perpendicular on the blade, so the dpdn is zero. At other boundaries, like here, the water can flow through, so we cannot say dpdn has a certain value, because we don't know how it flows, but we can say we know the pressure on that surface. And since everything is relative, we use a pressure of zero on those surfaces. So here you have 0, 0, 0, and here. Then at this is like a box, like a shoe box full of sand, and at the borders of that shoe box we also assume there is no water flowing through those walls and to the bottom. Yeah, so we assume dpdn is 0. Now you could say, yeah, but in reality there could still be some water flowing there. Okay, so you have to move those walls far away from where everything is happening, so it doesn't influence what you want to know around the shear plane. And the same for the bottom. So in fact what we did was many finite element calculations. You begin with a certain area, then you increase the area and you determine if every time I double the distance from the walls, when is the result less than, for example, 1%, and in that case, okay, now the walls are far enough because the result is within 1% accuracy. Where can the water come from? Well, here we have the shear plane again, and the water can come from any direction. So we have four directions where the water may come from. So in your finite element program, you also have to take care that it can come from those sides, so those walls cannot be impermeable. What does it look like? Well, here you have what we call the mesh. The mesh is just all those triangles, we call it the mesh. This is a coarse mesh, but what you can see is near the shear plane, the triangles are much smaller. We call it a fine mesh. Why do we do that? Well, we expect that near the shear plane, the pressures will differ a lot. We will have high pressure gradients, but if we go far away, like here, we do not really expect a lot of difference. And to reduce computer time, because I did those things in the mid-80s, and computers were not as fast as now, so you had to reduce computer time, otherwise you pay much more. In fact, in those days, one such calculation would cost about 100 guilders, so let's say 50 euros. And I had to do 1,000 of them. So that's 100,000 guilders. That was my budget. So you can imagine, if you want to do more from your research budget, you have to limit the computer time for each calculation. And we didn't have a PC. PCs didn't exist. We had a mainframe. We called it a mainframe. And you had to send a job to the mainframe. And if you were lucky, 1 week later, somewhere at where now you have architecture that used to be the main building of the university, they had a computer department, and there they would put the output of the calculations, so everybody had a file, and you could pick up your results. But usually it took a week. So your job would be in the, we call it a queue, like standing in line. And when it was your turn, the mainframe would do the calculations. And if there was something wrong with the calculation, you have to correct it, send it again, wait another week, and, well, that's the way it worked in those days. But it seems very primitive, and with what we know now, it was primitive. But in those days, that was the state of the art, so every researcher had the same problem. Yeah, so it was just the way it was. How do you know if the mesh is fine enough? Well, you can try a finer mesh and see if the outcome, again, is within like 1%. So first you do a series of tests with how coarse is the mesh, where do you have to put the borders, are all your boundary conditions correct, and once you find, okay, I'm within 1% accuracy, you can start your 1,000 calculations. This is the result of such a calculations. It shows what we call equipotential lines. And it's a fancy word, it just means lines with constant pressure. Here, this line, number 12, is the line with the biggest under pressure, which makes sense because it's the shear plane, so that's where you expect those under pressures. But you can see that the further you go away from that area, the higher the pressure, and in fact this line is a pressure which is almost zero, almost hydrostatic. I also have a color picture. In fact, it's the same picture, but now the brighter the color, the bigger the under pressure, and the blue here is almost the water pressure. Yeah, so you can see the whole pressure distribution. Well, if you know this pressure distribution, you can integrate pressures over the planes and you can determine the forces. Well, this is a picture of one of those calculations where you see the equipotential lines in red and the flow lines in blue. So here you can also see how the water flows to a certain area. And then you can also see that on one spot of the shear plane, water will only come from two directions. So for example, if you are close to here, it will come from this side and from this side. But if you are close to the edge, it will come from here and from the back. Yeah, it's not true that the water will come from four directions. It will only come from two directions. The result of all those calculations, and I will show you a little bit more next week, is some simple equations. So we already saw the basic equations with the two W's, but if we solve all the sines and cosines and the pore pressures and the integration of pore pressures and everything, you can simplify the equations. And like I said, at low velocities we do not have cavitation. We call it the non-cavitating cutting process, but at high velocities you have the cavitating cutting process. Well, let's only look at the horizontal forces. What do we have? A C1, and the C1 is the result of those finite element calculations and the result of all the sines and cosines. If you do not know a value for the C1, you take 0.5. It's some average of many different types of sand, so you can take 0.5. Then we see the density of water and the G. Normally, because dredging is usually at sea, so we have salt water, which would have a density of 0.03, something like that. G 9.81, but usually 1.03 times 9.81 for me is 10. It makes all the calculations more easy. But if you put it in a computer, yeah, then you can do it as accurate as possible. Then we see the VC. VC means, well, in Vietnam it means something else. It's the Viet Cong, but here it means cutting velocity. You know, I'm often in Vietnam because my second house is in Vietnam. So I go there every year. Anyway, VC in this case is cutting velocity. You can see the force is proportional to the cutting velocity. Why? Because if I would double my cutting velocity, the double amount of water has to flow to the shear plane in the same time, resulting, because the relation between pressure and flow is linear, resulting also in the double under pressure. H, you see it squared. H was the layer thickness. Well, what happens if my layer thickness doubles? The distance the water has to travel through the sand doubles, resulting in a double under pressure. But to get a force from those under pressures, I have to integrate, in fact, over the thickness of the layer cut, so I get my layer thickness again. And that's why the layer thickness is squared in the equation. The B is the width of the blade. In new publications I use the W, the small W, for the width, because this is from breedte in Dutch. So you can imagine if I double the width of the blade, that also means I double the force. The E is the dilatation, and dilatation is how much is the volume increasing because of the dilatation. Normally, for normal sands, the E would be 0.1, maximum 0.2. Which means if I start with 1 cubic meter of sand, after cutting it's 1.1 or 1.2 cubic meters. So it's really quite a lot of volume increase. And then finally the K is the permeability. How easy does the water flow through the sand? So it also determines my pressures. And the K would have a value for very dense sand, maybe 10 to the minus 5. For very loose sand, 10 to the minus 3. Okay, that's it for today. Next week, we will go on with this.